I'm always focused on making sure that you get news that is important and vital to you. One of the people that I want to bring on to the program is Richard Lopp, who is a pioneer. He's a pioneer, and let me explain to you why before we bring him on. He's a pioneer, and what he's doing with this organization, which he's co-founded for the United States of Europe, is so out of the box. It's been talked about for a long time, but it made international news, all right? Made international news, and I couldn't think of a better week to have you on. Hey, Richard, are you there?
I'm there.
All right. Richard, I appreciate you for coming on the program. Where are you today? Are you in Belgium, or where are you?
I am in Brussels, the capital city of Belgium.
All right, so you're in Brussels tonight, and I appreciate you for joining us. You know, it's late here; it's almost 12:30 in the morning. I know you've got some people that have probably given up on listening to the live stream here in Europe, but I can tell you that we're elated to have you on because I want to talk about this movement for the United States of Europe. There is a real movement that's happening. There are some people that have actually made some statements. And I want you to talk about what the United States of Europe is. And, of course, we're going to talk about some of the issues and problems with it as well that people have been pointing out in the news lately. So we have Richard with us, and we're going to talk about the United States of Europe and why you should know about this being in the United States of America, because we've got lots of Americans listening as well, Richard. So hold on to your hat, sir. I know that we're a little bit late getting started here, but what I want to do is I definitely want to have you discuss the United States of Europe and the concept of it in just a moment. This is Reading News Review. I'm Rob Reading, America's independent voice, giving you the pressing news that you need to know first on this program. Hang on. We're back with more and more. At 855-ROB-3080, they want changes in Europe. And they want to form the United States of Europe. As a matter of fact, there is a group that is having a resurgence, a real resurgence. It's all over the news lately. And we've got the co-founder of Stand Up for U.S. of Europe. He's with us. Richard Love, I appreciate you for taking out the time today to come on. Tell me what exactly is your group focused on?
You know, we're a group of citizens that are concerned by the decline of Western Europe, and we've come to the conclusion that no one single country can face up to the challenges that, you know, we're going to have to live up to in the future. So, you know, countries like Germany, France, England, you know, going at it alone is basically not an option. We believe faced with, you know, powers like the United States of America, China, India, Brazil. So we've decided that it was time to try to get together and try to convince the rest of the population here in Western Europe that there is a need for much bigger integration and to create what we call the United States of Europe so that we can speak of one voice and be heard again, talking about international matters vis-a-vis countries like the USA or China or India. So that's who we are. You know, we're not politicians. We are people coming from civil society, businessmen, artists, civil servants, students, from all breeds of society. And we've decided that we needed to voice our concern and try to convince the vast majority of the population that there is a need for much bigger integration.
Now, you're a business owner, and you got involved with this group. You're actually a co-founder in it. What made you want to do this as a business owner?
Well, because as a businessman, I travel the world. I've got businesses in China, in India, in Vietnam. I do some business in the USA as well, in Brazil, in Turkey, in Africa. And when I travel the world, I see what's going on in those emerging markets and the energy and the buzz that can be perceived. And whenever I come back to Western Europe, I get depressed depressed by the lack of energy and by the sense of decline that is all around us. And so it's kind of observing that state of affairs that I decided that we needed to try to rebalance, and got together with a few friends of mine to try to make this happen. So that's the reason behind this, the motivation behind this whole new initiative.
Vivian Redding, who is a chair, a president of the commission, the vice president of the EU commission, said she said that there is a strong case for a true fiscal, ultimately political union. She said that this week and caused a big furor because of it. What do you think about those comments?
No, I think she's spot on. I mean, you know, in the United States of America, 23 or 24% of the GDP is managed at the federal level. In Western Europe, it's less than 1%. And so clearly, you know, if you're just managing 1% of the collective GDP of the Western European continent, you know, clearly it's extremely difficult to join forces, you know. So it's absolutely vital for the European budget to be dramatically increased and for forces to be brought together so that, you know, we can start carrying our weight in the world again. Just taking one simple example, you know, you take the military. In Western Europe, we spend something like 250 billion euros every year in the military, which is half of what the U.S. of America spends. But this budget is spent individually in 28 different countries. And so the end result in terms of military effectiveness is not half of what happens in the USA, but it's probably 1/20th of the capabilities that America can bring to bear. So, you know, our goal, just talking about the military as an example, would be to bring this thing together, have one European army, one military budget, you know, which would allow us to be a lot more effective in the utilization of taxpayers' money. That's just one single example, but it has to be repeated on just about every single element of, you know, of the budget that's being spent in Europe.
Now, there's some people locally that have some problem. Go ahead. You were going to finish up.
No, go ahead. That's the key point. So, yes, we're fully behind what Vivian Redding has stated this week.
All right. So, and of course, she's no relation to me, but as far as I know, she's got one D in her name. I have two in mine. But the point is that she said it, and that's caused a tempest and an uproar. But here's the thing. I know you're saying how this could be advantageous to Europe, and some people disagree. We'll kind of come back to that in a moment. But how is this advantageous for America?
Well, I mean, you know, I think we're on both sides of the Atlantic living up the same set of values. The world is changing radically. You know, the whole power balance is shifting from the Western world to the East, to China, India, and those places. So I think it is in the interest of the U.S. of America that Western Europe stands its ground and, you know, can keep up with the pace of change in the world. So we are, you know, coming from the same background, the same culture. We share the same values. So I think America and Europe need to be together to face the new challenges of the world. And that will only happen if Western Europe has the capability of voicing its its position in the world like the U.S. of America has.
All right, hold on a second.
We're not doing this to go against America. We're doing this to be, you know, at par partners with America, and, you know, to build the capability with America to respond to the shift of power that is happening between the West and the East right now.
All right, hold on a second. We're going to come back because there is some opposition to this. We're going to discuss some of the opposition that's arisen because of Redding's comments. This is Redding News Review. I'm Rob Redding, America's independent voice, giving you the pressing news that you need to know first. 855-ROB-3080. That's 855-762-3080 to get into the radio show. We're talking about the United States of Europe. Back with more in moments. Hang on. 855-ROB-3080 to get into the radio program. That's 855-762-3080 to get into the radio program. We're talking about the United States of Europe. And a group that wants to unify Europe. And Vivian Redding, who is no relation to me, as far as I know, she talks about this, and she comes up against Richard a real opposition here from a gentleman from the Danish member of the European Parliament. His name is Morten Messerschmidt. And he says that there are so many issues, I'm quoting here, and crises in the EU countries right now, at the moment, and many of them have actually been created by the EU, he says. For instance, forming the Eurozone, trying to merge together very different economies in the South and the North. That obviously is the main reason why the Eurozone is still the only major economy in the world that is still in a recession. When it comes to the free movement, not only of workers, but citizens around the EU, that was obviously led to many problems. For example, in Denmark, he says, with beggars and criminals and other people coming transnationally from Eastern European countries without any possibility for our police forces to protect our country, not even after they have been expelled, we can be sure that they won't come back. Because due to Brussels, he said, regulations, we are prohibited from having border control. So many of these problems have actually come due to the EU regulation. So he doesn't consider himself a fan even of the EU Commission, which, of course, Redding is the vice president of.
Well, I mean, you're spot on. I mean, there's a lot of resistance, of course, in Europe to the idea we're trying to push forward. But, you know, let me ask you a question. If in the United States of America, there were borders between Alabama and Tennessee and Texas and Florida, I doubt whether the economy in America would actually be on a rebound like it is right now. So, I mean, you know, these are just natural reflexes of people that have very nationalistic perspective on the future of Europe. Now, there are admittedly some countries in Europe which are faring better than others, and clearly Denmark and Germany and Holland and Sweden are countries which are economically faring better than countries like France and Spain and Italy or Greece. And so they have the feeling that if we were to create a United States of Europe, that they would have to transfer some of the success of those countries to the benefit of the countries in the South. What they fail to understand, of course, is that 90% of what they're selling, if you take a country like Germany or Denmark or others, 70 to 80% of what they're exporting it to those southern European countries. So if you were to reinstate borders, they would be the first countries to suffer from reinstating those types of borders. So, you know, I think it takes a lot of explanation for people to understand that. But I think in America, most people fully understand that because you've got a huge market. It provides economies of scale. It provides opportunities for people to sell their products in a huge market of 400 million people. And it's helping the economy to thrive. In Western Europe, people... Yeah.
Go ahead. In Western Europe, you were saying there are people...
No. In Western Europe, unfortunately, you know, when you have a period of crisis, some people are just maybe trying to regroup amongst themselves, say, okay, well, you know, we have it nice here in Denmark, or we have it nice here in Germany. Let's kind of put the borders up again. Let's chase the immigrants. Let's put, you know, barriers again to protect ourselves. But we all know, you know, where that's heading to. You know, you start doing that, other people do the same, and everybody ends up suffering. So we believe there's a lot more benefit to be had from working the integration, creating solidarity, and making sure that there is, you know, a great unique market out there that everybody can work towards, both for capital and for people.
So Morten Messerschmidt, and what he's saying, he's being closed-minded, he's being selfish, he just wants to exclude people.
And many people, I mean, and I understand why, you know, if you feel like, you know, you've got some success in your own little environment and you're going to have to transfer some of that to countries, let's say, in the west of Europe, in the south of Europe, I can understand why they would have reflex for believing that they'll be better off if they close their borders. You know, we are of the exact opposite opinion. We believe that it's only open borders and free market and solidarity amongst the various countries in Europe that will allow us to thrive and to compete effectively in the global market.
Well, you know, there's a precedent for this with America. We saw North-South. The South was an agricultural economy, made less than the North. And you had these divisions there as well when things were in the early going, but obviously we're past that now. Atlanta's the crown jewel of the South and is not agricultural. It is very high tech. And it is, of course, home to Hartsfield International, the largest airport in the world, as you know. You travel all the time. How can folks find out more about what you are doing?
Well, I guess the simplest would be to go to our website. Unfortunately, most of it is in French. We started off here in Belgium. And, most of our material right now is being produced in French because we're going to the elections here in Belgium as a starting point. But there is some material in English on the website, so they can go and hit www.standupforuseurope.eu, and they'll be able to get a bit more content about what it is we're about, our objectives, the people that are supporting us, and what it is we're aiming for. So that's the simplest way to try to get more information about us. We'll be competing in the next elections in Belgium, the European elections, so I'm sure they'll hear about us through those elections. That's going to happen in May 25th. We're having elections for the European Parliament throughout the whole of Europe, and we will be presenting a list of candidates in Belgium for that particular election, and so we're going to be getting some decent media coverage as a result of participating in those elections. So hopefully that will give some publicity and means to people to find out a bit more about what we're about.
Richard Love, thank you so much for taking the time.
Thank you for having me.